afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Apostle Joseph Henry, Master Standard of Department of Civil Engineering and Architecture, Upper School of Science and Engineering, Southern Justice Society. May I use the opportunity to thank my supervisor, President Chai, assistance to Indonesia and make a trip to Thailand for the convention for the state. Having said that, the outline of my presentation, I'm going to present to you the current practice of subway improvement in our for road construction in Nigeria. Very common practice. The outline I'm going to present to us are the ground conditions of the site. The criteria we normally use to evaluate the existing subway, and I'll also present those two field cases, and finally, conclusions. I come from Nigeria, and just located in West Africa, and has a total area of 92,768 square kilometers. The population is about 191.3 million. And the capital city is Abuja. The official language is English, and we have over 250 ethnic tribes speaking languages in Abuja. Here's a map of Nigeria showing the federal road network. Why am I showing this map? In Nigeria, basically the main mode of transportation is road transport. This is because we don't have there's inadequate provisions for other forms of transport like railway and airports. Roads account for over 70% of passenger and freight movements within the country. Thus, you can see that the importance of road to our country is very, very important. The aim of my presentation, I just wish to highlight to us the very common current practice of subway improvement in Nigeria. I'll present to us two field cases, the construction of the 40-kilometer main way to Oduma Ogun, and the construction of the 56-kilometer Omana Diago Road project, both in Enugu State South is in Nigeria. I present to us the ground conditions of the site. Here is the map of Nigeria, and this is Enugu State, Nigeria. And the study area is located within Ezeagu, Udi, Ogu, and Aniri. The two road projects span those four local governments in Enugu State, and it basically provides roads for rural communities within Enugu State in the four local governments I've mentioned: Udi, Ezeagu, Ogu, and Aniri. Now, previous studies regarding the geology of the study area reveal the presence of shear formations and montmorillonite clay. In general, the geology consists of impermeable Enugu shale overlaid by impermeable sandstone beneath of mound formations and high impermeable adalic formations. Hence, the nature of the geology indicates that some soil formations within the region exhibit unsatisfactory engineering properties. In line with the requirement of section 4.24 of the Geotechnical Material Survey Code of Practice, the Highway Manual of the Federal Ministry of Works, part of which states that material survey should be carried out to identify the quantities of in situ materials that form the subgrade and all other materials required for the construction of roads. Following this, investigation of the engineering properties of subgrade and other materials during construction of the road projects was done. positive criteria that was used. The Federal Ministry of Works is the main organization of the federal government of Nigeria that is responsible for the construction of federal roads in the country. And they have a highway manual. In this manual, they've stipulated requirements for all subgrade and fuel materials. One, that the percentage passing for seed number 75 micrometers should not exceed 35%. Two, that the liquid limit, the subway should not exceed 50%. Three, that the plasticity index should not exceed 30%. Four, that minimum soaked CBR for the subway should be 15%. And then five, that subway soils should be modified whenever the CBR value is less than 15%. I present to you a first field case, the Nimwe Uruma road project. The road is about 40 kilometers, sorry. And soil analysis we conducted on the existing subgrade. The highway manual of the Federal Ministry of Works specifies that we sample the existing subgrade within 0 to 0.5 meter and 0.5 to 1 meter, obtain two samples at that depth, within that depth. Now, liquid limit, plastic limit, and plasticity index were all determined for the soil that was obtained from this depth. And we can see from the table that the FMW specification states that the liquid limit should be less than or equal to 50 and the plasticity index should be less than or equal to 30 was met on most sections of the road. This first criteria was met on most sections of the road. However, the percentage passing seed 75 micrometer for the samples did not satisfy the requirement here. As we can see in the table here, the values were far more than the value here. And from the grain size distribution curve as well, you can see it did not meet our specifications. Also, the water content and dry density plots, and then the CBR that was determined for the soil sample showed that the CBR had a value of 2%, and this was less than our specification. And remember, I said that when you have a CBR value that's less than 15%, the subgrade needs to be modified. Now, this brings us to what is the most common way, the most economical way we do this. The most common way we do is we excavate the subgrade to the depth of sampling, and then we replace the excavated subgrade with suitable material. After that is done, we borrow a material from the borrow pit, but before that is brought to the site, we subject the borrowed material to the previous test I have earlier on highlighted. And our borrowed material in this case had a liquid limit of 18.5%, which satisfies our liquid limit specification. The material was also found to be non-plastic. That was also okay. And the percentage passing seed number 75 micrometer also was okay. Similarly, the CBR was determined as well, and you can see that it was more than the minimum CBR value that is required. This showed that the material was suitable to be used as a replacement material for the subgrade that was excavated. And the material is normally lateritic material, borrowed and filled in layers. Now, in the field, the in-situ density compaction test for the field layers is normally conducted. And the in-situ density compaction should be greater than or equal to 100% of the maximum dry density using the British standard compaction method. When this is done, we are sure that the material that has been borrowed and has been compacted satisfies, is properly densified, well compacted. I present also a similar case again for field case 2. Also here, you can see here that the liquid limit, plastic limit, elasticity index values, the liquid limits and the plasticity index values are higher than the value, minimum values specified. They fail. Here as well, this is higher than the minimum. It fails as well. So, we excavate out again, like the first case. And then we look for the suitable material to borrow and fill back. Both material in this case again met our specification. Same here, the grain size distribution curve satisfies our specification. And then the CBR value too satisfies our specification as well. And once that is done, filling and compaction layers is normally done. And you can see the maximum dry density test is normally conducted to ensure that the material being filled is properly compacted. This is basically the very common practice of subgrain improvement that is done in my country, Nigeria. For cases that are not very severe, this is one common practice that we do on most projects in the country. Conclusion. For my presentation, minimum subgrain engineering properties required by the Federal National Highway Manual for Road Construction in Nigeria was presented. Replacement of unsuitable subgrain material with suitable lateritic soil material is a common and economical method used for subgrain improvements in Nigeria. Thank you for your attention.